Welcome to the video introduction to the Energy Policy Simulator, or EPS. The EPS is a free and open source computer model that can help you design packages of policies to reduce pollution. You can visualize policies' effects on emissions, cash flows, power plants, electric vehicles, and more. This video is the first in a short series about the EPS. It provides a useful overview and background about the tool. Subsequent videos give you a tour of the simulator's user-friendly web interface and a look under the hood at the inner workings of the tool, including its input data and how the EPS can be adapted for different countries or regions. Links to all of the videos in this series appear in the comments field. Why create an energy policy simulator? Many policymakers have goals they want to meet, such as reducing greenhouse gas emissions, saving money, or preventing illnesses and deaths from pollution. The best way to achieve these goals is to select policies on the basis of objective, nonpartisan data and a transparent, peer-reviewed calculation framework. That is what the EPS offers. As of March 2018, versions of the simulator have been constructed for 6 countries. The first version was built for China in partnership with 2 agencies within the Chinese central government. They use the tool to assess policies for inclusion in China's 13th five-year plan, as well as ways of achieving China's commitment under the Paris Climate Accord. The second version, for the United States, was initially released in October 2015. It has been featured in the media, used in academic courses, and boasts hundreds of users per week. The adaptations for Mexico, Indonesia, Poland, and Canada were each developed in partnership with local nonprofit organizations or government groups. The simulator's modular data set and flexible course structure make it easy to adapt to widely varying countries or regions. The key challenge facing policymakers is not to identify a policy that would reduce emissions. Rather, it is to sort through the hundreds of policies that might reduce emissions to find the ones that will do so efficiently and cost-effectively. Policymakers have limited time, limited money, and limited political capital, so they need to hone in on those policies that will achieve the best outcomes. This task is made more challenging by the fact that policies interact with one another. In other words, the results of one policy depend on which other policies are in effect at the same time. For example, suppose you study a policy that would promote wind power, and you find that it would reduce emissions by 1 unit. Then, you study a policy that would promote energy efficiency in buildings, and you find that it would also reduce emissions by 1 unit. Then you enact them both. The emissions reduction you will achieve is likely to be less than 2 units, because some of the energy savings from the efficiency policy will come out of power generated by wind due to the wind policy. The opposite relationship can also occur. For example, a policy that promotes electric vehicles becomes more effective at reducing emissions when the electric grid is more decarbonized. When you are dealing with dozens or hundreds of interacting policies, you need a computer model to understand their combined effects. The EPS is a system dynamics model. That means it assumes the system is ever-changing and dynamic, not in equilibrium. Those of you who are familiar with computer models may have heard of top-down models, such as partial equilibrium or computable general equilibrium models. These models often hail from the world of economics and include a variety of assumptions. For instance, they may assume that actors in the economy are rational and have complete knowledge of the goods and services available to them. Another type of computer model is a bottom-up or engineering analysis model. These models often start from an equipment or energy use perspective and determine potential savings by counting things, such as the number of inefficient air conditioners that could be replaced with efficient air conditioners and how much electricity would be saved as a result. The EPS follows neither of these approaches, though it sometimes uses input data and information on interactions from other models. For example, the EPS uses price elasticities of demand that could be derived from a top-down model, and certain policies act within technical limits that may be estimated by a bottom-up model. For the most part, however, the EPS attempts to replicate the important interactions in the energy system, tracking flows of specific things, such as vehicles, energy, and money. It does not assume that the system is in equilibrium or that actors are rational, nor does it assume that technical potentials are fully achieved. It attempts to use whatever structure would produce the most realistic estimate of real-world policy effects. The necessary structure varies considerably from economic sector to sector. Next, we'll take a look at the high-level structure of the EPS. Four of the largest components are the transportation, buildings, industry, and electricity sectors. The first three are the demand sectors because they demand energy, including electricity, and they tell the electricity sector how much power to produce, accounting for transmission and distribution losses. Like electricity, district heat is an energy carrier, hot water or steam that is generated at a central facility and pumped to nearby buildings. District heat is important in some countries, such as China, where it provides heat for many buildings in the winter. It is not used in other countries, such as Mexico. The EPS core structure aims to include all components that could be needed by any country or region, but not every country or region will use every EPS component. There is also a carbon capture and sequestration, or CCS, module. It allows industry and power plants to store some of their carbon emissions underground, and it increases their fuel consumption to power that sequestration process. Upstream of all this is the fuels component. This is where the properties of various fuels are set, such as their costs and their emissions intensities, which vary by pollutant, by type of fuel, and by technology burning that fuel. Certain policies, such as a carbon tax, can affect fuel prices here, and that effect trickles down to influence the fuel-using sectors. There is also a full set of research and development, or R&D, control levers. There are actually three types of R&D in the model. In the business-as-usual case, most technologies gradually become cheaper and more fuel-efficient over time. For example, the cost of building a natural gas power plant or a building heating system declines according to a time-based schedule. For newer technologies, such as wind, solar, and batteries, the model uses an endogenous learning curve based on how much of that technology has been deployed, cumulatively, to date. This means that the more solar panels are deployed, the lower the cost of future solar panels. This reflects the benefits of learning by doing, as well as returns to scale in the refinement of new technologies. This set of R&D levers allows you to explore scenarios that feature R&D advancement above and beyond R&D caused by the two mechanisms noted before. You can specify different rates of additional R&D progress for fuel economy and for capital cost for each technology tracked by the model. For example, in the building sector, you could choose different values for building heating systems, building cooling systems, building lighting systems, and so forth. The last sector tracked by the EPS handles emissions and sequestration from land use and land use change. This encompasses forestry, deforestation, peat fires, and so forth. Pollutants are one of the most important outputs of the model. The EPS estimates emissions of 12 different pollutants. Four are greenhouse gases: carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and F-gases, or high global warming potential fluorinated gases. Four are particulates: PM10, or particulate matter 10 microns or less in aerodynamic diameter, PM2.5, black carbon, and organic carbon. There are also four other pollutants: nitrogen oxides or NOx, sulfur oxides or SOx, volatile organic compounds or VOCs, and carbon monoxide. All of these are primary pollutants, which means they are emitted directly. The EPS does not track secondary pollutants, such as ozone, which are formed by chemical reactions in the atmosphere. Outputs from the EPS can be used as inputs to a gridded air quality model, such as CMAQ or GeoSchem, to predict how policy will affect air quality. Changes in cash flows are another important output from the EPS. By changes in cash flows, I mean either costs or savings caused by policy relative to the business as usual case. The model tracks cash flow impacts on a number of different actors: government, industry, consumers, and certain specially broken out industries, such as the coal industry or the natural gas and petroleum industry. The EPS offers many other outputs, such as the number of electric vehicles on the roads, an estimate of human lives saved due to reductions in particulate matter emissions, and more. In fact, any value calculated by the model can be used as an output if desired. The web interface, which is demonstrated in another video in this series, includes a variety of the most useful outputs. Each sector of the EPS is subdivided into different categories for which calculations are made individually. In many cases, policies can be set to different levels for each category. For example, in the buildings sector, buildings are broken down into different building components, such as heating systems and lighting systems. Buildings are also subdivided by building type. Unsurprisingly, the industry sector is subdivided by industry. The EPS tracks emissions from fuel use, as well as process emissions. Process emissions are those emissions unrelated to fuel combustion, such as CO2 emitted from carbonate rock that is broken down to produce clinker, one of the main components of cement. Agriculture, here, is treated as an industry. This section of the model handles fuel use by agricultural equipment, as well as process emissions, such as methane released from livestock operations. If land use is changing to support agriculture, those land use changes are handled in the land use sector of the EPS. The electricity sector is subdivided by electricity source. The model considers heat rates, capacity factors, and other properties of power plants. The transportation sector is divided up by vehicle type, including both passenger and freight modes. For example, there are passenger aircraft and freight aircraft, passenger rail and freight rail, and so forth. The on-road modes, meaning cars, buses, trucks, and motorbikes, are further subdivided by vehicle technology, such as electric vehicles or vehicles with a gasoline or a diesel engine. Many organizations have contributed to or reviewed the EPS, including top universities, U.S. national laboratories, non-governmental organizations, and partner organizations in various countries. For example, researchers at Argonne National Laboratory reviewed the EPS's transportation and fuels calculations and made many helpful suggestions that were incorporated into the model's design. Thanks for checking out this overview of the Energy Policy Simulator. As a reminder, this is the first video in a short series about the EPS. The other videos offer a tour of the simulator's user-friendly web interface and a look under the hood at the inner workings of the tool, including its input data and how the EPS can be adapted for different countries or regions. Links to all of these videos appear in the comments field.